Welcome to Dr. Panash.
Good afternoon, sir.
Will start?
Yes, sir. I'm just inserting the this thing.
Just a second. Take your time. No problem. Should we start?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to this evening, to afternoon episode of Pursue. And today we have Pursue 5Q, which is General Pathology and Immunology. And the topic for today is very, very interesting. It's immunity, graft rejection, and AIDS. And to talk on that, we have our specialist in General Pathology and Immunology, Dr. Major Palash Kumar Mandal, who's an MD, Associate Professor of Pathology, Sagar Datta Medical College, Kolkata. Also is a Lab Director of Dhisan Hospital and Heart Institute, Kolkata. Before I ask him to start, let me request all of you to please keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me request Major Mandal. Sir, please share your screen and start. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Right, I can see your screen here.
Good afternoon, everybody. I wish you a Merry Christmas and a coming Happy New Year. This year has been extremely disastrous for all of us, and I hope the new year brings some relief and joy to us and our families. With this, I begin the last lecture of immunity, graft rejection, and autoimmune AIDS. So we will discuss a little bit on graft rejection, because graft rejection itself is a very big topic. If you study graft rejection, especially the details are given in kidney, in relation to kidney diseases, that's quite a big topic. I will just brief upon the graft rejection, because it is a part of immunity, and we will discuss more on AIDS. Okay, so with this, so graft rejection. What is actually a rejection? Rejection means whenever a transplanted, whenever an organ or a tissue is transplanted in another person. If there is a rejection by the body, which is immune mediated, that is called graft rejection. So rejection actually may happen through various processes. It may be through cellular rejection, it may be through humoral rejection, but the whole process itself is a quite complex process. And in fact, both cell mediated immunity and the humoral immunity, they both have a role to play in this type of rejection. And since kidney is the one solid organ which has been transplanted in the maximum number of patients all over the world since its inception, so that has been studied in details, and we will be discussing a bit of that also. But I will give you an idea of what actually rejection is. Okay, so what how this rejection process happens is basically whenever the tissue which has been transplanted is damaged by an inflammatory reaction by the body. Okay, so the tissue which has been transplanted is destroyed, destruction by a process of inflammation. And who carries out this inflammation? This immune mediated inflammation. It is an immune mediated inflammation, one by cellular immune response, that is the T cells, which are the most important cells in this regard, and the second is the humoral inflammation, that is inflammation mediated through the production of antibodies, that is the activation of B cells. But again, here also T cells play an important role, if you remember. So even in humoral immunity, T cells, that is CD4 lymphocytes, they have an active role to play. And based on this, the cellular rejection has been divided into acute, that is direct rejection, and chronic, that is indirect rejection. And the humoral rejection is hyperacute and acute. So this is the baseline, that cellular can be acute or chronic. Acute is also known as direct, and chronic is known as indirect. And the humoral is divided into hyperacute and acute. Okay, so this you have to remember, because even in the BAMF classification, which where the kidney rejection, the graft rejection has been studied in details, that classification also uses these very criteria to classify what type of rejection is happening. Okay, because if the body is rejecting a transplant, the whole process is nullified. The whole process, the preparation, the taking of the organ from another donor, selection, and the money involved in everything is totally gone to drain. So that we definitely don't want it to happen. So that's why it has been studied, and why this is happening, if you can understand the pathology behind it, so we can stop it, we can do some things so that this type of rejection does not happen in the person. Okay, so as you know, there are two types of molecules, that is one class 1 MHC molecules, which are associated with CD8 type of lymphocyte, that's a cytotoxic lymphocyte, and we have another molecules, that is class 2 MHC molecules, which are associated by CD4 lymphocyte. So these are called restriction. So class 2 molecules are restricted for CD4 group of cells, and class 1 molecules are restricted for CD8 group of T cells. Okay, and as you know, this CD4 eventually, what they do, they will lead to production of two type of subclass of cells, that is Th1 group of cells and Th17 group of cells, and eventually they will lead to production of some cytokines, and eventual the end process will be bringing some inflammatory cells to that area and causing inflammatory response and eventually inflammatory damage to the area where it is happening. Okay, so basis of inflammation, as you know, or this hypersensitivity, this is all if you remember the hypersensitivity, so this is all about hypersensitivity also. Okay, so basically this whole process is a type of hypersensitivity reaction, though it is not classified in hypersensitivity as such, but it is a kind of hypersensitivity reaction where the inflammatory cells damage the foreign tissue, that is the grafted organ, and eventually the organ has to be removed from the body. Okay. So this is the same. This picture has been taken from Robbins. I would ask all of you who are attending this lecture or who will listen to this lecture again in future, so please go through Robbins, which has very well illustrated these things, and you can have a better idea once you go through it. At least you need to give a solid reading for this, because this is a complex thing. As I told you, immunity is a chapter which has to be thoroughly read, and read in between the lines. Okay, So it is not that you have some time, say 5-10 minutes, you go through the chapter of immunity, you will fail to understand the basics of immunity. So please, when you have some time, read up, read it again, refer to my lecture, and then go back to your book again, and then only you will have a solid understanding of this chapter. It is, this rejection is even important for MD students. Okay, so BAMF classification is very important, is asked as a short note for MD students as well. So here what is shown is that in direct pathway, these two, class 1 and class 2, both molecules may be involved. Okay, and here the CD8 lymphocytes, which are also known as cytotoxic T lymphocytes, they directly damage the endothelial cells of the blood vessels. Here, since it is a kidney, so renal blood vessels, the endothelial cells of the renal blood vessels are directly attacked and there is an inflammatory reaction. Okay, so there is the vasculitis, these tubules are also damaged by the cytotoxic T cells, the endothelial, tubular cells, the columnar cells or cuboidal cells of the tubules, renal tubules, they are also damaged, and eventually the total organ is destroyed. The function of the kidney is to filter the blood to form the urine. That filtration whole part is destroyed, because if the tubules and blood vessels are destroyed, so the function will not be performed. The kidney will not be able to perform the actual function what it is supposed to do. Okay. Same with the class CD4 type of cells. Through this direct pathway also, this CD4 class 2 MHC molecules may activate CD4 cells, and in indirect pathway also the CD4 molecules may be activated. And as you know, CD4 molecules, they release this cytokine, that is interferon gamma, which leads to the activation of macrophages. The macrophages are activated, and the same type of activity, the same inflammatory reactions in the renal blood vessels, this is happening. Okay. So we have all discussed these similar things, so I am not repeating. We have all discussed the function of these activated macrophages, what type of secretions they can do, and how they are activated by interferon gamma and things like that. Okay. So, and CD4 cells, they also lead to the activation of B lymphocytes. Now, B lymphocytes, as you know, they can only release antibodies once they are transformed into plasma cells, and that is through a special class switch. The class switch is necessary because the antibodies have to be very specific against the specific antigen. So class switch happens, and this class switch leads to the production of a specific group of plasma cells, and the specific group of plasma cells do lead to a specific antibody release, and which goes and attacks the desired substance, that is the foreign area, that is the kidney which has come from outside, a donor kidney which has been transplanted or put inside the body of the recipient. Okay, the person, that is the person of a chronic renal failure patient who has received a kidney, so that kidney has been attacked. Now, here what they are saying that since the kidney is the most common, commonly transplanted organ, we will have some discussion on kidney itself so that you have a better idea on the kidney disease. So, what are the clinical features of acute cellular rejection, which happens within months? Okay. So, the clinical features will be renal failure. Patient who was suffering from chronic renal failure, after transplant, this kidney function should improve. The failure should go away. The creatinine, the blood urea creatinine level should come down. But instead, if it starts again going up, so that means the renal failure has set in. Okay. And the T cells of the recipient recognize the donor MHC molecules, what we had just discussed, and there is this inflammatory cell accumulation, and a delayed delayed type of hypersensitivity reaction leads to graft injury. Okay, there's a spelling mistake. Hypersensitivity is single word, this comma should not have been there. Okay, so there is a delayed type of hypersensitivity and acute reaction, which is also known as direct reaction. Microscopically, what do we see? the interstitial mononuclear cell infiltrate, edema, hemorrhage, tumoral necrosis, and endothelitis. We just discussed all these things. And how do we treat them? By again immunosuppressive drugs like cyclosporine. Okay. The indirect reaction, which is also known as chronic rejection. Indirect reaction or chronic rejection. This was acute cellular rejection. This is chronic cellular rejection. Okay. So now here what happens? The graft antigen leads to the activation of host APCs. APCs are antigen presenting cells. Basically the dendritic cells, the macrophages. Here what was the APC? The APC here was the dendritic cell of the donor. The dendritic cell of the donor was the APCs or the of the donor, which acted as APC for the CD8 cell and CD4 cells. But here it is the host APC which is acting. Okay. So there is a difference. So now this activation leads to the activation of CD4 cells, and CD4 cells, as you know, they can activate the B cells, and immunoglobulin production is there, leading to the immunoglobulin are produced against the endothelial cell, leading to endothelial injury. Interferon gamma is produced again here also, leading to delayed type of hypersensitivity, and gradually a progressive renal failure sets in. Microscopically, you will see the intimal fibrosis, that is the vascular changes. The intimal fibrosis, chronic inflammatory infiltrate in the interstitium of the glomerulus, that is happening, and along with tubular atrophy and glomerular scarring, that is loss of renal parenchyma, is taking place gradually. It's a chronic rejection. It takes some time. Okay. Humoral rejection, which is the basic thing, is vasculitis. The blood vessels are the ones which are targeted by the antibodies. Okay. So hyperacute rejection here happens within minutes or hours after transplant. Why does it happen? How can it happen so fast? Because the persons are already sensitized to the donor antibody. How can it happen? How can the person be sensitized? A multiparous lady, and if she has taken her husband's kidney or she has taken her son's or daughter's kidney, then the person and the person's immune system has already experienced the cells of the relative, that is the either the son or the daughter or the husband. So through that, this HLA since the HLA association is already there, this immune system has already recognized the antigen as a foreign antigen and immediately reacts to reject it. Okay. So the person who has experienced multiple blood transfusions, who has already had a previous rejected kidney and husband's kidney in a multiparous woman, or even children's kidney, so these people can have hyperacute rejection, which is a very serious thing. The kidney becomes cyanosed and mottled, and immunoglobulin CC, that is complement, is deposited in vessel walls, neutrophils and arterioles, glomeruli, etc., and there is necrosis of the renal cortex. The kidney is destroyed within hours, not even a day, within hours. And acute humoral rejection, it takes some days, and in non-sensitized person, complement dependent cytotoxicity, inflammation, that is ADCC, which is again hypersensitivity reaction, type 2 hypersensitivity reaction, if you remember correctly. So that is happening, and that is leading to acute humoral rejection. And here we see necrotizing vasculitis, endothelial cell necrosis, deposition of the immunoglobulins, fibrin, etc. Okay. So these are the pictures which have been taken from Robbins. I will again not go into the details, but just to show you, and I always insist that students should have a practice habit of drawing diagrams, though these are photomicrographs, but I will request you to have a practice of drawing hand-drawn diagrams. This is an image of a glomerulus where you see the endothelial damage, the thrombi, the red clots are actually fibrin thrombi, platelet and fibrin thrombi, and the small cells are the neutrophil infiltrates. Okay, within the glomerulus, this is the glomerulus and this is happening and it is hyperacute rejection. Okay, humoral type, hyperacute rejection. Here is the acute cellular rejection by T cells. Here what is happening? The aggregates of inflammatory cell within the interstitium. These are the tubular cells, this is the interstitium, and you see the black dot 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 dots. These are the chronic inflammatory cells, the lymphocytes, the plasma cells, the macrophages. Okay, so this is the between the interstitium and the tubules. Fine, the second picture. The third picture is of a acute humoral rejection. What is happening here? Rejection vasculitis. See, this is the blood vessel. This is a blood vessel. So here there is dense aggregates of chronic inflammatory cells. Okay, and also the proliferating smooth muscle. The smooth muscles are there. The smooth muscles are also involved. That is, the inflammatory cells, they do attack the smooth muscles in the intima. So this is the smooth muscle of the vessel. This is the endothelial cell. This is the lumen, and everything is attacked by the inflammatory cells. Okay, so this is acute humoral rejection. We have chronic rejection. So here there is arteriosclerosis, tubular atrophy, everything, the glomerulus, the glomerula have become sclerosed. Okay, so you are not, the tubules are there and they are showing features of atrophy. Okay, the small tubules. And there is fibrosis of the interstitium. The tubular loss is there. The parenchyma is lost. And what happens here? Here is the graft arteriosclerosis. Okay. The arterioles, the glomerulus, there is arteriosclerosis and it becomes sclerosed. The whole glomerulus becomes sclerosed and the function is totally lost. Okay. So with that we end with the graft rejection. I had to hurry up because if I go too much into graft rejection, then our topic of today, and that is HIV/AIDS, so that will be delayed. So AIDS, I am starting with from here. Okay, as you know, acquired immune deficiency syndrome, AIDS, is a well-known disease. It is not a new disease. It started in the 80s and it has continued for this long. Okay, so 40 years have passed, but it is still quite strong, let me tell you. So these retroviruses, these RNA viruses, they have created havoc in the world, and the latest example is the COVID virus. Okay, so you see, we have, in spite of our advancement, drastic improvement in the medical science, but we have not been able to conquer these small tiny viruses even till now. Okay, so let us see how we can conquer them in future. But with that hope, we continue with that. So what is autoimmune disease? That is, what is the acquired immune deficiency syndrome? So it is also called modern plague, and it belongs to the family of lentivirus retroviridae group, and there are two subtypes, HIV 1 and 2. I think these are all well known facts and figures, and statistically almost 36.7 million people were living with AIDS at the end of 2016. It is a relative and it's a somewhat old data, and every year almost 1.8 million people are becoming infected. That was happening in 2016. Okay, and in Indian report, the adult HIV prevalence is estimated is to be 0.3% in males and 0.22% in females. That was in 2015. And the good news is that due to the public health measures and heart, that is highly sensitive antiretroviral therapy, so that is, infection rate seems to be decreasing. and the number of people living with AIDS, HIV in India was estimated to be 21 point something lakhs in 2015 as compared to 22.26 lakhs in 2007. So there is definite decline in the HIV AIDS in India. Okay, that has been statistically proved also. So because of the health awareness, because of the public awareness, this has decreased, and also that antiretroviral therapy is responsible for that. Okay. Now, these are all known facts and figures. How HIV AIDS is transmitted? Basically through blood and body fluids. Okay. If you ask me, the one line answer will be through blood and body fluids. Through unprotected sex, shared needles, from infected mother, and from blood products, it can come from one person to other. Now, structure, coming to the virus itself. What is this HIV virus? It is a spherical virus. The electron microscopic picture is depicted here and contains electron dense cone shaped core surrounded by a lipid envelope derived from the host cell. This envelope is derived from the host cell itself. This lipid layer. Okay, you see the lipid layer? And the virus core contains major capsid protein P24. You see this P24, major capsid proteins. Okay, this is the bilayer, and this is the yellow, the golden is the major capsid protein, that is P24. The bilayer is the outside, the reddish or the brownish area is the lipid bilayer. Nucleocapsid protein P7 and P9. This is again a nucleocapsid protein are there, P7 and P9, and two copies of genomic RNA. You see, one RNA, another RNA. There are two copies of genomic RNA and three viral enzymes. This reverse transcriptase, protease and integrase. So these are the enzymes. Okay, protease, integrase and reverse transcriptase. Okay, so this is in a nutshell the structure of HIV virus. Now, HIV genome, as we discussed, two identical RNA strands are there. It's a diploid virus. It is a diploid virus having two RNA strands, and it contains three structural genes: the gag gene, the pol gene, and the M gene, and some non-structural regulatory genes, and product of both these genes acts as antigens. Okay, the structural genes as well as the non-structural genes, the product, that is the protein which is generated after the transcription, they all act as antigens for the virus. That is, if they enter the host, so all these will be antigens. Okay. Now, the genes coding for the structural proteins, gag gene determines the core and shell of the virus, expressed as a precursor protein P55, and P55 is cleaved into three subtypes, that is P15, P18 and P24. Okay. So, this is depicted here pictorially. M gene determines synthesis of envelope glycoprotein GP160. It's a fusion glycoprotein and it's cleaved into two envelope components, GP120 and GP41. 120 forms the surface spikes and the GP41 the transmembrane anchoring proteins. Here you see GP120 and GP41, the spike and the this roundish portion. Okay, it looks like an apple with a stalk. Pol gene codes for polymerase, reverse transcriptase, and viral enzymes like protease and endonuclease. So they codes for all these enzymes, in fact. Okay. And it is cleaved into P31, 51, P66. Pathogenicity. HIV mainly affects the immune system and the central nervous system. This is very important. That is why this disease has been, the disease which happens with HIV is known as autoimmune deficiency syndrome. So there is deficiency of the immune system, that artificial deficiency which is created, that is the that is caused by this HIV. There is loss of the CD4 cells, this T lymphocytes. There is a drastic decrease in the count of these lymphocytes, which leads to the reduced immune status of the individual. That is the main story behind this HIV infection. And they also directly attack the CNS, causing a host of problems. We will discuss it definitely today. And this profound immunodeficiency affecting the cell-mediated immunity is the hallmark of the disease. And where does it enter through? Obviously through mucosal tissue and the blood route. Okay. And it infects the T cells, then the dendritic cells and the macrophages. So directly it goes and attacks the T cells. That is the the main thing about this disease. Directly it will go and attack the T cells. And of the T cells, CD4 cells are the more vulnerable cells. Okay. And now life cycle, the infection of cells, the integration of provirus into the host cell genome, the activation of the viral replication, production and release of infectious viruses. Okay. So this is in a nutshell. The cell is infected. There is integration of the provirus into the host cell genome. The provirus goes and integrates into the host cell genome itself. Okay. The body's DNA, there is integration of the viral RNA and the host cell DNA, and that the host cell the DNA becomes the slave of the viral RNA, and it acts on the orders of viral RNA and leads to the activation and replication of the virus within the host cell, and eventually the host cell gets damaged or it busts open, releasing the four replicated virions. Okay. So this is again a picture from Robbins. This general pathology, Robbins is an excellent book. Robbins is such a book where general pathology as well as systemic pathology are discussed, but for general pathology it is the book. And for the latest things, the newer molecules and everything is given in such intricate details, and the pictures are also so good that it is really worth reading. So what happens? This is the host cell. Okay, this is the host cell, and this is the host DNA. Okay, this is the host cell. Bilayer membrane, lipid bilayer, and the virus, this is CD4 cell, the chemokine receptors are there, and the virus is entering here. The GP120 and CD4 binding, this is the, there is the CD4 receptor on the host cell, that is, this is a CD4 lymphocyte, this is a T lymphocyte, this elongated cell is a T lymphocyte. Okay, now there is the binding happens with this GP120, which is GP41 and GP120 together. So this GP120 goes and binds to the CD4, and there is a conformational change which happens, and eventually there is binding of the CD4 with the CCR5 and all these things. This is a chemokine receptor, and eventually the host and the virus RNA that goes into the host cytoplasm and eventually goes to the nucleus of the host, that is the nucleus of the T lymphocyte, and it goes and integrates itself into the host DNA. That is the problem. If it did not integrate itself with the host DNA, things would not have been so serious. It integrates itself into the host DNA and there is RNA virus transcript. Okay. Instead of producing T cells, this leads to production of HIV particles. HIV RNA transcripts are produced and eventually there is synthesis of HIV proteins and the assembly of variant core structures leading to the full-fledged HIV virus. So this is a HIV, full-fledged HIV virus, and while going out, it takes the lipid bilayer with it and the full virion, virion is complete. Okay, so it takes the lipid layer, bilayer from the host itself. You see how beautifully it has been shown. It is taking the lipid bilayer from the host and the whole new HIV variant is synthesized. Okay. And how the infection is happening? Initially, it goes and attacks the CD4 cells, and then it also comes in contact with the dendritic cells and drains to the draining lymph node and spleen, and infection is established in the lymphoid tissue. Okay, the lymphoid tissue are the areas, the storehouses of these viruses. Okay, and this leads to the release of there is acute retroviral syndrome, which leads to spreading of the infection throughout the body. Through the lymphatics, the virus reaches to different nodes, not one node but different nodes, and also in the bloodstream, leading to viremia. Okay, and there is an immune response which is generated in the host body. There are anti-HIV antibodies are formed. HIV specific cytotoxic lymphocytes are generated, and there is partial control of the viral replication. The body tries to defend itself. You see, the body has to defend itself. So body cannot let the infection overcome the host defense, but unfortunately the body's defense mechanism fails at one point of time, and this after the initial immune response, the body has kind of given way to it, because the body is no longer able to control. Though the immune response is generated and there is a continuous tug of war which keeps on going on between the HIV virus and the body's immune system, but eventually the virus is the one who comes out winner. Okay, there is a partial control of virus replication, and there is latent infection and low level of infection. Initially the infection is of a low level, latent infection. The virus are gradually multiplying and establishing themselves in the various lymphoid tissues or lymphoid organs of our body, and at one point of time there is extensive viral replication and CD4 cell lysis. That is when the actual problem starts. That is when the HIV becomes, in the infection becomes AIDS. Okay, the infection becomes AIDS. The immune deficiency occurs, the true immune deficiency occurs, and the lymphoid tissues are destroyed, and there is extensive destruction of the CD4 lymphocytes. Okay, clinical stages. The primary stage, that is acute retroviral syndrome, there is viral replication of lymph node in the lymph nodes, and viremia happens. Number of HIV particles increased in the blood, that is the HIV particles are found in the blood. Within 3 to 7 weeks after this, seroconversion happens. Seroconversion means the body starts producing antibodies against the HIV virus, that is human HIV virus, that is the all the body's the effort that is the body's starting to just kill the virus, to attack the virus through its various mechanisms, through CD8 lymphocytes, so through CD4 lymphocytes, and it is attacking the virus, and there is CD8 T cells are generated which specifically acts against the HIV virus, and they try to kill the HIV virus, and there is transient reduction of the viral load. Virus in the viral infection is contained to certain extent, And during this period, there are non-specific clinical symptoms like sore throat, myalgia, rash, fever, weight loss, etc., resembling a flu-like syndrome. So any viral infection, they can produce a flu-like syndrome. Same thing happens with COVID infection also. So these are the non-specific syndrome which cannot be attributed to a particular virus. Okay. The fate of the patient after primary infection. Most but or not all progress to AIDS after chronic phase of 7 to 10 years. So there is a latency, long latent period, 7 to 10 years. The virus is it tries to establish itself throughout the patient's body, the lymphoid organs, and after that period, depending on the host's immune status, the body will virus will supervene. Okay. In some cases where the patient's immune system is already low, immunity is already low, maybe a chronic diabetic patient, maybe a renal failure patient, maybe a malignant cancer patient. So there is a rapid progression in 2 to 3 years. And in some of them, the lucky ones, it can stay in the body for 10 years or more, and they are termed as non-progressors. That is in 5 to 15% of the patients. And the last, which are the luckiest ones, after 18 to 19 years, there is no detectable virus in the plasma of the infected individuals. Those are known as elite controllers. They are the luckiest ones. Clinical stages with manifestation of AIDS. The first is the chronic infection, phase of clinical latency. There is continuous HIV replication and cell destruction in the lymph node and spleen. This keeps on happening. There is destruction. Bodies again replenishes them. But eventually the replenishment rate becomes slower than the destruction rate. Okay. Initially, there are actually few clinical symptoms or manifestations and no significant change in the number of CD4 T cells. Later on, there is a gradual and steady fall in the number of CD4 lymphocytes and persistent generalized lymphadenopathy and AIDS-related complex. This AIDS-related complex, this is the one which actually is very, very dangerous, and that leads to the death of the person. Now, how HIV escapes host defense mechanism? The body's immune response is quite strong, but in spite of that, how does it escape? The destruction of CD4 cells, the direct attack by the HIV on the CD4 cells is very critical. Okay. There is antigenic variation, which most of the microorganisms, they are quite capable of. You can name any virus, even the COVID virus that has started antigenic variations. The disease spread in the second wave that is happening in UK is a classic example, and people are saying that antigenic variations have taken place in various parts of the world, including South Africa, and even people are claiming that in India also antigenic variations have taken place. So let us see. So in HIV also there is antigenic variation, so body cannot recognize that as a previously experienced antigen. Okay. There is down modulation of class 1 in MHC of the infected cells. So this down modulation is an indirect effect by the HIV virus itself. It down regulates the body's own immune system, and there is a co-receptor switch from CCR5 to CXCR4 or both, leading to rapid reduction of the CD4 lymphocytes. Okay, this co-receptor switch is necessary for the reduction of the T lymphocytes, and this, you see, four receptors were there, CCR5, which were leading to the conformational change and the virus attachment of the virus, okay, and eventually the transportation of the HIV genome, okay. So these were carried out by these co-receptors, and this co-receptor switch from CCR5 to CXCR4, that leads to the reduction of CD4 cells. Now AIDS, typical presentation of AIDS is long lasting fever, fatigue, weight loss, chronic persistent diarrhea. Weight loss has to be more than 10% in 1 month, fever for more than 1 month, and persistent diarrhea. Okay, CDC classification, Center of Disease Control classification categories: asymptomatic, acute, more than 500 T cells, CD4 cells per microliter, 200 to 499 cells, less than 200 cells. If asymptomatic, AIDS indicator condition. So this is the classification: A1, A2, A3, B1, B2, B3, C1, C2, C3. So if it is not in A or C, it becomes automatically B. Symptoms not in A or C. Okay, so this is the classification which is still followed, and based on that we can categorize the patient, how serious or the patient is. Now AIDS defining opportunistic infections. These are the opportunistic infections. They are this often asked in the Viva table. So what are the AIDS defining opportunistic infections? First are the protozoal and helminthic infections, the cryptosporidiosis. Okay, so cryptosporidiosis is enteritis. Okay, so gastroenteritis caused by cryptosporidium, that is cryptosporidiosis. Toxoplasmosis leading to pneumonia or CNS infection. Fungal infections, pneumocystis zerovici, pneumocystis is earlier known as pneumocystis carinii, but now known as pneumocystis zerovici. Candidiasis, esophageal, tracheal or pulmonary, cryptococcosis, especially in the CNS, histoplasmosis, disseminated histoplasmosis, bacterial infections like by mycobacterium, tuberculosis or mycobacterium other than tuberculosis known as MOT, nocardiosis, disseminated salmonella infection, they are called opportunistic infections in AIDS. The viral infections may be cytomegalovirus, the herpes simplex virus, usually disseminated, varicella zoster virus, localized or disseminated, progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, that is prion related disease. Okay, so all these are AIDS defining opportunistic infections. Now tumors, commonest tumor which is described is Kaposi's sarcoma, but it's a vascular tumor, but there are other tumors also. Lymphomas, systemic, non-Hodgkin B-cell lymphoma, and especially two types are more important: primary CNS lymphomas and body cavity based lymphomas. These are the two categories of lymphomas which are classically associated with AIDS: primary CNS lymphoma and the body cavity, that is the pleural cavity based lymphoma or the peritoneal cavity based lymphoma. Though other cavities are also there, but these two are described more commonly. Hodgkin lymphoma is a rare, usually non-Hodgkin high-grade lymphoma is common. Cervical cancer, anal cancer, CNS disease. See, more than 90% patients show some kind of neurologic involvement, either meningoencephalitis, aseptic meningitis, vascular myelopathy, peripheral neuropathies, and most commonly progressive encephalopathy designated AIDS dementia complex. So HIV directly attacks the CNS. As I told you, the immune system, that is the especially the T lymphocytes and the brain. Okay, so it has got the predilection for these two organs. Okay, K kidney and genitourinary tract HIV associated nephropathy, genitourinary tract infections like syphilis, which would have been treated by antibiotics, they become long-standing, vulvovaginal candidiasis. So these are all these genitourinary tract infections. And especially in kidney, there is a term called collapsing glomerulopathy. So that is important. So collapsing glomerulopathy is nothing but destruction of the glomerulus by the HIV virus, the immune related destruction, and eventually the glomerulus becomes atrophied, collapsed. That is why it is known as collapsing glomerulopathy. Now coming to the lab diagnosis. So HIV you see is a very big topic by itself, and individual infections can be dealt for a long time, but since we have paucity of time, I would request you to go through it once again on your own. If you have any doubts, you can clarify with us and I will be happy to answer your queries. And now I am shifting to lab diagnosis. Now, specific test for HIV infection: antigen detection, virus isolation, detection of the viral nucleic acid, and antibody detection. It's quite obvious. Just hold on. Ekto baki ache, ekto baki ache. Call kuch. So as it is obvious, the virus detection or antigenic detection is we have to resort to more expensive tests like PCR. Okay, antibody detection can be used by detected by the antibodies can be detected by cheaper modalities like immunochromatographic modality, ELISA testing. Okay, a non-specific test. Obviously, whenever a person or a patient comes to us, we do order a host of tests. So here, the non-specific tests are actually the total and differential leukocyte count, and if it is suspected the patient is might be suffering from AIDS or is a chronic patient of AIDS, that is at least the patient has been detected having AIDS, so that patient or HIV patient will be subjected to this T lymphocyte subset assay, that is basically the CD4 cell count. Okay, platelet count, immunoglobulin levels, and skin test for cell mediated immunity testing. Specific test is antigen detection test. And as you know, after a massive infection, the virus antigen P24 and reverse transcriptase may be detected in blood after 2 weeks of infection. Okay, so after 2 weeks, this P24 antigen and reverse transcriptase, the enzyme antigen, may be detected. P24 antigen is the earliest viral marker to appear in the blood, and IgM appear in about 4 to 6 weeks, followed by IgG. Okay, if the infecting zone is small, in case of a needle stick injury, the process may be considerably delayed. Okay, appearance of pre-24 antigenemia and viremia coincides with the acute illness. So we discussed the acute illness, acute phase, that is acute viral viremia, which consists of myalgia, non-specific symptoms like fever, headache, this loss of appetite and things like that, rash. And P24 antigen may be detected by this capture assay, that is ELISA technique. Detection of the viral nucleic acid. So this is through PCR. Okay, most specific and sensitive and specific test, and it is the gold standard for diagnosis of all stages of HIV. So we have a DNA PCR, we have a RNA PCR. DNA PCR is actually RT-PCR, reverse transcriptase PCR, because it is an RNA, which is the genome is actually an RNA genome in HIV. Antibody detection, 2 to 8 weeks to months for the antibodies to appear after infection. Okay, so this period during which there is no antibody detection in the blood, antibodies may have started to be produced within the body, but for the detection to be there, for us to detect the antibody through our modern or the through the methods which are presently available to us, it takes some time. Okay, so if the body's antibody levels are so low that we are not being able to detect with our present day kits, so that period is known as the window period. So where we cannot detect the antibody, and the infection may be detected during the window period by P24 ELISA assay or by RT-PCR of the antigen or the nucleic acid. Okay. So what is the window period which can be detected? So this is the diagram which is shown, and final test which can be done by us is either the viral isolation, that is by this PCR method, or by Western blot method, where we detect the antibody. The screening test by ELISA, the rapid test and the simple test, the supplement test, that is the Western blot test, indirect immunofluorescence test, and the radioimmunoprecipitation assay. The ELISA technique is the most commonly used test. The antigen is obtained from the HIV grown in continuous T-cell lymphocyte cell line, and the test serum, the patient's and serum is added, because that is what the serum only contains the antibody. The antigens are present in the kit, and the antibody is received, or the antibody is present in the patient's serum. So that antibody of the patient binds to the antigen, which is artificially synthesized, and then the reaction happens and it is detected by the ELISA reader. Okay, there are readers which can detect, and they can also tell the level of antibody which is present in the person. And rapid tests are there, like cassette ELISAs or immunochromatographic ELISAs, where the coated particle agglutination, this rapid tests are basically the card tests. Okay, we have a triple dot test. We have a card test where HIV-1, HIV-2 and a control dot is there, or control line is there. So if the control is negative, then the test is nullified. If the control is positive and one of them is positive, then we can say that test is positive. Okay. It's mostly used, widely used screening technique, and there are the generations, first, second, third, fourth generation ELISA. This is the pictorial description. Photomicrograph actually, and not micrograph, this is a photograph of the ELISA wells. Western blot is the confirmatory test, and it is this test, HIV protein separated according to the electrophoretic mobility by this gel electrophoresis and blotted into strips of nitrocellulose paper. Okay. The antibodies against the NGAG-POL genes are there, so which can be detected, and interpretation may be as negative, positive, or indeterminate. So this is the criteria, CDC criteria, any 2, that is GP20, GP120, GP41, GP24. So the antibodies against this can be detected. Indirect tests, as I told you, there is leukopenia and a lymphocyte count is decreased, anemia may be present, thrombocytopenia may be present, and immunological test, CD4 count may be reduced, immunoglobulin levels may be high, reduced CMI, that is cell mediated immunity, and we can do a, since there is a lymph node, generalized lymphadenopathy, we can do a lymph node biopsy. Preventive measures, this is the last thing, actually this is a community medicine topic, but we should all know that the needle should not be recapped and thrown into the dustbins. They are recycled and reused, so they should be, and you should not break it with your you should not bend or try to break needle with your own hands. You can have a needle stick injury, and the needles should be destroyed or disposed of in safe, this puncture proof containers, which are always we advise those for waste disposals. Whenever we are saying that waste disposal, these sharps should be discarded in a separate way. They are shredded and they are actually destroyed by the persons who is disposing the waste. There are companies are there who are authorized to dispose the waste generated in the laboratories, the hospitals. They are the infectious waste. Okay. And what should we do after needle stick injuries? Those are all depicted. I am not going to go into details, but don't cut or don't suck the prick finger. The basic thing is that wash with soap and water, and there is no added advantage with any disinfectant or bleach, and then post exposure prophylaxis, that is with the antiviral agent, should be started as early as possible. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Palash. Excellently presented. Whatever is relevant and whatever is required for graft versus host disease as well as for HIV/AIDS, you have very nicely presented all that. I think that is what is required, and the details about opportunistic infection and specific infection, everybody can go and read, because if you are dealing with all these, it will be a very long topic.
Yes,
thank
yes.
you so much. What is going to be the next topic, sir?
Sir, we will start with neoplasia.
Okay, so fine. We'll start with immunology is over, so we'll start with
neoplasia. Yes.
Right. Thank you so much. Take care. Bye-bye. Good night.
Thank you, sir.
Good day.